Morning. I'd like to welcome everybody out to our services this morning. We're going to be continuing on in the study in chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians on the subject of walking honestly here in just a minute. Just for those who might be curious or wonder what happened last week, we had the service go down. I mean, they pulled it off probably to some music-related issues, which is usually what it is. But Amanda got it back up there this morning, so if you do want to view that, it is available for viewing online. So I'm glad about that. And so that was last week's lesson. And what we're going to be doing this morning is kind of examining the basis for why the apostle taught them what he taught them last week, that we studied last week. And so we'll get into that in just a minute. But before we do, let's take a moment of time and go to the Lord in a word of prayer. And I'll go ahead and lead us at this time. Loving Father, we give you thanks today for this blessed day you've given us and for the life and health you provided each one of us, for all the care you've given us, Lord, and our families, for watching over us in this land. We thank you and we praise you. We thank you for your Son and his great sacrifice for our sins and all that entails, all we have and are in Christ Jesus. We ask, Father, that you'll bless this day, that you'll teach us from your word this morning, that you might give me that which I stand in need of, bring this lesson, that it might be spirit-led, and that every word professed, Lord, might be that which is your truth and only your truth. Father, that you might help us to grow and mature in your word and to apply these things to our lives. Father, we pray that you will save souls today and make a change in the lives of your people, that you would help us to grow and mature spiritually each day. Father, help us to choose to live better lives. Help us to choose choose actions and thoughts after the inner man, Lord, not after the flesh. And we pray that you give us the strength to resist our desires and temptations to do evil. Father, help us to be a light in the world. Help us to be witnesses. And then we pray that you'll provide opportunities for us to do that. Please go with this now, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so it's too late. So my wife and I had it's good. Anyway, so we're talking on the subject of walking honestly, and I want to take a moment and I'm going to go back and read a little bit before what we're going to be looking at, just to refresh everybody's mind to it. But if I start in verse 1 and read on down to verse 6, here's what we've looked at so far on this subject. It says, "Furthermore, then, we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as you have received of us how ye ought to walk, and to please God, so you would abound more and more. For you know what commandments we gave you by the Lord. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication, that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor, not in the lust of concupiscence, even as the Gentiles which know not God. That no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter, because that the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we also have forewarned you and testified." And so he was talking a lot about the subject of fornication, and really which encompassed the thought of adultery as well. And he was teaching them that these things shouldn't be a part of their process in life. They shouldn't enter into these things, and they shouldn't, you know, defraud a brother by coveting or causing the wife of that individual to be thinking about someone other than her husband, right? So these thoughts were kind of, and a lot of this is driven by the regional behaviors of those that live there. Whether it be the people that worshiped at the false gods' temples, or those just in their pattern or way of life. We see it in pretty much every culture these days. And so he was teaching them that this was not how they should walk or things that they should be caught up in. And now he's going to give them the rationale for it. And I just realized I don't have my PowerPoint up yet, so I'm just going to get that going here. And get us to where we're going to be. So we're talking now about the subject of a holy calling, verse 7. The rationale was then discussed by Paul in this verse that follows. So what his rationale for giving them the instruction we just read that we've already studied is now revealed in this next verse, which says, "For God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness." Now, before I get into this, I'm going to know this is an ouch moment, right? This is, I think if we're human at all and we can admit, you know, that we're not perfect, then when we get into this subject, it should convict us, because we're going to be able to look at our own lives and think about the way, what we think about how we feel about things. And we're going to see what God is saying to us to move away from. So it's a stinger. I mean, it's kind of right there for us, right? "For God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness." So we have been called to holiness. There could be no more profound reason to adopt a clean and holy lifestyle than because that is the sort of life in which God has called his children. So we should want to adopt this lifestyle and make it a pattern for our life, because it's the pattern of life that God wants us to be. And when we do, then it'll be something that the world notices, because it's not the pattern of the world. I mean, understand what I'm saying. When you talk about the world, yeah, of course, a lot of people love in the world, and whether they're saved children of God or not, or there's a lot of people that maybe don't know the Lord as their personal savior, but are trying to be good people in society. But it should absolutely be the earmark of the child of God. And it should be something that we labor to perfect. And if so, it'll come out in ways that are profound. Meaning that if your heart is in tune with the Lord, then the natural process of that is going to be, or the natural result of that is going to be, which comes out. If your natural heart is now in tune with the love of God, then the love of God is going to come out. If it's your desire and purpose to be honest, then honesty is going to come out. And these things are going to be not just things that you say, but that they're actual actions and doings, you know, so that they become us. They become our pattern, our nature, our behavior. And some might say, well, you know, I've noticed you're not this or you're not that. You know, that's them seeing a pattern of behavior that is consistent with the tuning that's gone on inside. And that is to be in tune with God. And I got this picture that I'm going to bring up here. Some of these pictures are a little fuzzy. I don't know what it is. When I get them on there, they get a little fuzzy. But I like this picture for this subject, because it says, give life a meaning. And I think that's the greatest meaning we can give it, is when we pattern it after Jesus Christ, or after the ways of God, or in line with his instruction. So that means that such moral behavior puts the believer and the Lord in harmony together. Now imagine that. When the believer and the Lord are now in harmony together, that life is blessed. It's going to be because of that, but it's also going to manifest that harmony. The patterns or ways or behaviors of life, this is the thing that convicts, because when we allow our sin nature to become dominant, whether it's regarding a thing or a pattern of life or just in life in general, then we're not in harmony with the Lord. So everything that we do at that point, it really is kind of lending itself to that Lord of our life, in this case, our sin nature that we've yielded to. And so it'll become more consistent, more easier to do, and it'll become more of a thing that we might even adopt as a pattern of life, which we want to avoid. But when we're in harmony with the Lord, then that which is coming out is that which is produced by that harmony. And that's a better thing. And that's what glorifies God. You know, it's one thing, and I'm saying a lot of this really from the perspective of what's inside, your inner, not what everyone sees, but what really is the true inside you, what you really believe on the subject, what you really strive for in your own heart, Because that's what God's looking at, right? That's the thing that's going to drive everything else. So if it's in your heart that you want to try to please God and you want to resist certain things as a result because you think it might please God, then that's a real thing. And that's a thing that glorifies God. And no one has to even see that, although they will, but no one has to even see it because God sees it. He knows that it's your desire to be a good person or to strive to be, you know, someone who lives life with meaning in Christ Jesus, the one that is striving to not disappoint God with certain thoughts or behaviors or patterns of life. And so that will continue to get, you'll continue to exercise yourself in that way to the point where it'll become a natural thing. I've used this example before, and I'll continue to use it because I think it's a pretty good one. But back when I was a younger guy and I was trying to do things that was pleasing to God, I would always frustrate myself because I had to think about it. Like I had to think to do that thing that would please God because I didn't do it naturally. And then I noticed over the period of time that it became more natural. But what I used to beat myself up a lot about that, but what I come to understand, it was better to make an effort to remember to do something that pleased God than to not do it at all. So it was beneficial, even if I'm having to make an effort and it wasn't natural. But over time, some of those patterns develop into natural patterns. Like, for example, being mindful of others in certain situations. We may not think about it unless we make effort to think about others in certain situations where other people just do it naturally. You ever see someone just do something naturally for someone else and you're like, why didn't I think of that? Why didn't I think of that? Because it's just their pattern now to do it because they've trained themselves to follow that pattern. And it's something obviously I've practiced to the point or that was taught them by somebody else's example. These are all things that all go together in the subject. Now, we're talking about specific kinds of morality here that are really in focus, and that's the subjects that we brought up in our reading from the last couple lessons we studied in this chapter. But it is really applicable across the whole band of sin. In other words, we call the truth of that verse is still the truth. We are called to holiness. And that's what God has desired for us. It is possible that believers can adopt do right doctrine without clear specifics of proper or improper behavior in which a child of God should or should not engage. And that's a mouthful. But what's being said here is we can pick up a pattern of do right, but don't have the specifics. Paul's not guilty of that. He didn't leave any margin for error. He was not guilty of teaching just a general idea. He was very bold. He stated boldly that God did not call his children to ungodly living marked by fornication and adultery, but rather calls his children to holiness or sanctification, set apart, meaning I can fool you all, and I can, while you're looking, I can behave a certain way and not do a certain thing. That's easy. This is really talking about what's inside. Who are we inside? Because who we are inside is going to affect what we do outside. And it's about changing the inner and aligning that with in harmony and God, with God, because that's what's going to make the difference. And so when this changes and this changes because of this teaching, then that's going to be a profound result. And then I won't have to worry about fooling you because it'll just be natural because that's the result it will produce. Being in harmony with God in all these areas of life will produce a right result. It should. Now we're going to look at verse 8. So we're going to talk now about all truth known. This is okay. I know it's coming. And this is a stinger because see, it's one thing that I can stand up here and talk to you and I can tell you all this stuff, but in reality, God knows me through and through. He knows every fault, every off thought, every poor pattern, all of it. He knows it all. And there's a reason, because he's God. But his spirit also knows everything about me, because the spirit indwells me. So this is what was said. Let me go back here. All truth known. Paul then concluded his very plain remarks regarding the inappropriateness of immorality and any sort of evil behavior with a very clear statement. He says, "He therefore that despiseth not man, but God, who hath also given unto us his Holy Spirit." So there's the woe. There's the woe. Woe. Because he who despises not man, but God. And there's something very strong that's being said there that we can validate in the scriptures. And he's also saying, who hath given unto us his Holy Spirit. Now, that is the earnest of our inheritance, is the Spirit of God. But that Holy Spirit of God knows our hearts, searches our hearts, and knows everything about us. So God knows every thought. Some might be tempted to deflect accountability by claiming they are simply sinning against a brother, you know, which is bad enough, right? But we might say, oh, well, I ain't sinning against, I just did a bad thing against the brother. But really, it's bigger than that. Because this conclusion is absolutely contradictory to the Word of God. For the Bible declares the fact that all sin is directly aimed at God. So we can validate this by the conversion of the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. All right. When Paul was stopped and struck blind on the road to Damascus, the first words he heard were recorded by Luke. It says, "And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" See, what Saul was doing was he was persecuting those of that way, the believers of Jesus Christ. He was persecuting them and in a very strong and vile way. And so Jesus says, "Why do you persecute me?" See, as you've done it to these, you've done it to me. And that's the point that he was making to Saul. Why have you persecuted me when you've done it to these? And Saul/Paul said, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the Lord said, "I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks or the goads." It is hard for you. Can you imagine kicking against a cactus? There's these, I was up hunting a couple weeks ago, Northern California, and there's this bush up there. I call it buckbrush. I hate that bush. I know it serves a purpose, but I hate that stuff. And the reason I hate it is because it has spikes on it about an inch and a half long. And when you're walking through it, it'll pierce your pants like you're in shorts. It don't care about Levi's. It don't care about any kind of material like that. What's worse is when your son goes through it before you and he whips one back, and when he passes through and it comes back and spikes you in the leg. Yeah, felt that a couple times. And so I wouldn't want to lay in it, and I surely would not want to kick against it. So it kind of gives me that's what comes to mind when I think of this, is that bush, because it's just a mean little bush. It doesn't like people. Anyway, so I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. So Jesus identifying what we do when we sin against a brother. We're sinning against him. The reality check ahead. All the anger and hostility Saul had demonstrated against the followers of the Lord Jesus, Jesus told him were really against me. There's a reality check. And so when we're sinning against God. And it's as simple as that. We can try to minimize it all we want, but in reality, that's what we're doing. And that's sobering. See, these are the things that help us. If we can get them in and keep them, you know, when we're talking about aligning ourselves with God, and we're talking about, you know, when we're sinning, that we're sinning against God and how God feels about it. These things, if we remember them in moments of life, they will help right the way. They will help right the way, because we'll call to mind in that moment that this is a trespass, or it's gonna be a sin, and we can resist or strive to. And probably won't resist every sin there ever was and will be in our lives. But if you resisted that one, you resisted that one. If you didn't do this wrong thing, you didn't do the wrong thing. And those all add up to one better way. And so it's a challenge, but it's also sobering to know just how God feels about it and what it is that we do when we do it. And so Paul was very upfront with these individuals. So in other words, when a child of God is wrong, God is wrong because God is so closely identified with his children. Certainly, this is a truth that elevates the odious nature of sin. It does elevate it because now, instead of just, we just see it as a sin like this, now we're seeing it it's directly to God, right? And how does he put up with this? Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So what Chuck was talking about was the example of David and how he had sinned, how it says Nathan said he had sinned against God when he had an affair with Bathsheba, and although that he found forgiveness because he had true repentance. He paid a price, though. The sin, he paid the price for that sin, a big price. And so we have a lot of examples in Scripture of how sin is destructive, not only to our relationship, it hinders our relationship with God. But I always ask a question, how does he put up with this? It just goes to show you how strong and powerful the blood of Jesus Christ is. And it's really amazing when you think about ourselves. Just, if you just think about who you are and what you're about, that God can love us that much. A prime example, where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. And that's true. But what should we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. And that's the instruction we're getting here as well. It certainly elevates the nature of sin when you look at it in this light. King David, in his confession of sin to God in the Psalms, and it's wonderful that you brought that up, Brother Greener, because now we've discussed it, right? In his confession of sin to God in the Psalms stated this truth. He says, "Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mayest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest." And that's what he's referring to. In other words, he knew that even though he trespassed against, or he had wronged, even clearly wronged Bathsheba's husband, Uriah, and all Israel, yet in the end, he sinned against God himself. And so I think it's beautiful that you brought that up because it was part of where we were going. He knew. Can you imagine? Oh, he got so far that he sends the husband to the front lines and basically had him killed. That's where sin can lead us. It can certainly lead us down a destructive path. As Paul remembered these brethren reminded these brethren in Thessalonica, the same God gave these brethren the gift of the indwelling Holy Spirit who verifies the truth. So the Holy Spirit of God, which let me just bring this one up too. The indwelling Holy Spirit would verify to the hearts of these believers the truthfulness of the words of Paul. Not only does the Holy Spirit of God search our hearts, and I'll be honest with you, I'm ashamed of what the Spirit sees in my heart from time to time, but I'm also thankful because he prays and intercedes on my behalf. You know, he helps me when I'm praying to pray what I need to pray for, even if I'm not articulating it. But the Holy Spirit of God also reveals the truth to us. People say, how do you know? How do you know? The Holy Spirit is how we know. How do we know we're saved children of God? Because of the whole indwelling Holy Spirit. I knew it the minute it happened. So the minute I asked the Lord to come into my heart and life and save me, I knew it, that he had done that. But that's why this particular portion of what we're studying here this morning is so valuable at identifying the earnest of our inheritance, which is the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is revealing to us and teaching us and showing us those things that the Word is saying, and that the Word is true. And you know, the Spirit also teaches us and validates to us that if we yield to it, that it will produce that which it says it will produce. Generally speaking, if you can get aligned with God, with the Lord in here, life will be better. And I'm not talking about better in maybe, I have wealth or riches. That doesn't always produce better. You know, to some people, it's a curse. God knows what we have need of. But the things that really matter inwardly will be more abundant. I like peace. I like calm. I like to be rested and not restless. Things that I value, and especially as I age, we'll find that we're at greater peace. We'll have better relationships. Our hearts and minds won't be as troubled. So, it should be a given, but unfortunately, it's not. Loving one another is paramount. Verse 9. You know, there's a lot said in the scriptures about loving one another. Some epistles tie it to an earmark of salvation. So Jesus commanded it. But Paul then changed his focus from the purity of lifestyle that should be found in all children of God to the subject of love towards the brethren. Paul stated in 1 Thessalonians 4:9, "But as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another." So, as touching brotherly love, you need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. Although Paul stated that these brethren didn't need to be reminded about the subject of brotherly love, he would give them a gentle reminder. Christian believers should love one another as much or more than they love those in their physical families. I think that does happen, actually, naturally. I have, I don't know, I guess it's a normal family, normal size family, and I love my family. But I've found that over the years, I really love my brothers and sisters in Christ. And I'm not just saying that. I mean, I care about what happens to them and that they're okay and what goes on in their lives, as I would my own siblings. I feel that in return too. I do. And so, you know, especially in, you know, we're not a huge church. Of course, when we all get together, we can make a huge sound. We can get rowdy and loud and stuff, especially if there's food around. But there's love here. And I've always felt that from God's people, but not all of them. You know what I'm saying? There's some that do struggle with this topic here. And it's unfortunate because we're really called to love our brothers and sisters in Christ. In fact, Paul assured these brethren that God had taught and would continue to teach them of this proper relationship. I brought this picture up because we're going to be talking about this subject right here of Jesus on the cross before he went to the cross, though. But I wanted this picture up here because even though it's, you know, obviously not the real, it's a picture of portraying Jesus on the cross, but it is the fullest expression of love. I think about when Jesus was up there and he's on the cross and he says, Eli, lama sabachthani? And I think about that and I put me right in there. In other words, he was forsaken for me. And he didn't have to be. I think of the second chapter of Philippians where it talks about him being, it was not robbery to be equal with God. He thought not robbery to be equal with God, but took on the form of a man, and having been found in the form of a man, was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross, even the shame of the cross, the most shameful and vile thing he was subject to for my sin. Greater love hath no man than this, a man lay down his life for his friends. And that's expressed on the cross of Calvary. That's another, the reason I bring that up is because that's another motivator for living a life that's moral and not sinful because of Jesus' love for us. So the night before Jesus was crucified, Jesus gave his apostles a new commandment, which was recorded in John and states, "A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another, as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another." So this expression, I personally believe Jesus was saying this because it would be an earmark of their character. When others see that you love each other with this form of love and an endearing form, that they're going to know you're my disciples, that this is the pattern. So it's a pattern of the Christian to be loving each other and being Christ-like in that. So that's something to think about, right? And I don't know that it's a necessary subject for this church, but nevertheless, it's good to have it be a motivator, because I believe there's a lot of love here, but it's good to have it be a motivator in our own life for, you know, pleasing God and striving for what is going to glorify him. This concept of what should be a natural response to those who have accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior was elevated by Jesus himself to a commandment. "A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another." So we are literally commanded by Jesus to love one another. And so that's a very real thing. And it is elevated by him because of him doing so. The word love here is a form of the same word used in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world." It's understand the word, and it's elevated by Jesus himself. So when you look at the word that's used in John 3:16, which we're familiar with, agape, the word itself is elevated by the fact it's applied to God's love. So the minute it's used to refer to the love of God, the word is elevated. It's the same kind of love that's being talked about here, the same love that Jesus had for us. It manifests itself in his children of God. And if it manifests itself in the children of God, people will know we're his disciples because we love like that. That means not only do we love the brethren, we love men because we understand they're created in God's image and after his likeness, and he died for them. So it really manifests itself in a lot of very powerful ways. I'm going to do this to your brains. This next thing, I always, should I put this in there? Should I not put this? Okay, so one commentator writes, listen to this. "In fact, it is the present subjective second person plural form." Oh, it is the present subjective second person plural form meaning that you all might be loving one another. It carries the idea of motion again. It's a moving thing. It's not just something that was done and it's not done no more. It's continual. It's something that is not only growing or going, but it's growing. It's going and it's growing. So that the love is going out, but it's also growing over the course of time. So basically what happens is as we mature spiritually, then our love grows with us. Because let's be honest, the more of the Word of God that directs our life, the more spiritually mature we're becoming. And the natural process of that is what it produces. And it's going to produce love, patience, kindness, gentleness. Yes, even if you're married. Yes, even if you have little kids or teenagers. I think God made the teenage years to help us be okay with them leaving, you know, growing up and moving out. Just help us out with that right there. Okay, guy, time for you to go. Have a good life. No, but naturally, as the Word of God just becomes our nature, it's going to produce what it produces. All the things that God wants to produce in us, a sanctified life. You know, sanctification, I just want to pontificate a little bit on sanctification. It's in here. This has got what has to be sanctified. I can fool you, like I said earlier, but this has to be sanctified. This is what is going to change everything outwardly. It's also what's going to change this. So the more this changes, the more this changes, what it's doing. The thought process change. But I'll be the first one to stand up and tell you, it's the flesh is a difficult foe. And one that is hard to tame. But that's why these words are here for us. Because these words tame the flesh. The more they are a part of our daily thinking or reading or whatever, they're going to have that impact. And they're going to be, and praying. Praying is a big thing too. Certainly we find power when we pray. Present subjective second person plural form. That you all might be loving one another. The love Jesus commanded his followers to manifest towards one another is as intense and meaningful as the love he manifested towards all humanity. And I always look at the cross when I think of the love of Jesus, I think of the cross because of the reasons I've already stated. But it helps me put it in. I mean, that's one picture in my mind that instantly takes me to the powerful love of Jesus Christ. Jesus did not stop with the giving of this new commandment. He elevated the importance and value of this great love brethren were commanded to exercise toward each other as to their identification. So it's our earmark or it's our identification mark. Loving, and especially loving the brethren, is our identifier. That's why I said we're going to be identified as Christians by this pattern of life that is loving, you know? Besides, it's fun. Loving's fun. The one thing you can do that doesn't make you feel bad, right? Never make you feel bad. Well, I gotta think about that. Meaning, you won't have felt bad for having loved somebody. Doesn't mean you won't get hurt, but you won't have felt bad for offering love. Obviously, others watching the behavior between Christian brethren as they interact with one another should expect to see such love and care for each other. This kind of love and care for each other. as we start to bring this lesson to a close, I just got a couple more things for you. Such a response would be a marvelous help in carrying out the work the Lord gave us, his churches, to do. I think that the church's success is contingent on its ability to love. And that means each other, for sure, but others, like when they come in. We've had visitors, a lot of visitors over the years, and we're thankful for them. And some are not visitors anymore. They're members. But it is one of those things where when someone comes in, the earmark of us is going to be loving. That's what they're going to. And I watch. I what I love about this church is when somebody walks in, they get so much attention. I mean, in a good way. Like they get introduced and they get talked to and people are very friendly. And I love that. And I think that's genuine. I don't think it's fake at all. And I love that about this place. It's been that way for a long time. And I'm thankful to God. But it will be our earmark. It'll be our character, our part. And it'll help us do that which he's called us to do as a church, as witnesses in the world for the cause of Christ, for their sakes and for his glory. So, you know, it's hard to talk about the love of God when you don't love. You know what I mean? It's kind of like an oxymoron. If you don't love, but you're going to talk about the love of God, that doesn't work. Just a short time after Jesus gave the apostles this new commandment, as he and the apostles walked towards the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus stopped and prayed for these special men. This prayer is recorded in John 17, and it's a beautiful prayer. If you have never read it, I would encourage you to go read it and just see the heart of Jesus in this very, very touching prayer, but also in this very tender moment. So it's properly called the Lord's Prayer. But it's just a prayer of intercession, and it's endearing. So I would encourage you to read that. But anyways, as he prayed for these men who comprised his church, Jesus spoke of the closeness of each to one another and the Father. He urged them to be united as one with the Father. Then he made a wonderful statement about the result of such unity among the brethren when he said, "I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hath loved them as thou hast loved me." I wanted to bring this in too, because this is, again, when we're talking about the very first verse we started off with, verse 7, which said, we're not called to uncleanliness, but holiness. These are things that will move that action in our life. These are, when we look at this, what Jesus said here, "I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hath loved them as thou hast loved me." That makes your heart want to be good, because that's a beautiful thing. And not only that, I'm thankful it was Jesus that prayed this, because I know it got answered. And so I believe that wholly. And so this is another thing just right here that just will move us to yield ourselves and align ourselves with God, not in uncleanliness, but in holiness. It'll convict, and in a good way. I like this kind of conviction. This is good. It warms my heart. And that's a good kind of conviction to have, you know, a motivation to want to be better for Jesus, because he loves me and he prayed this for my sake. The threefold promise of Jesus is astounding in its breadth and scope. It is. It's hard to even fathom the depth of what he actually prayed and how it manifests itself and all the ways it manifests itself. I believe when I go back and I think about the accident my wife was almost in, I think that's just one facet of the manifestation of this care that God, we don't always see how many times, you know, they always say, well, there's a wreck up ahead. Well, or this happened, or this, I got delayed here. Well, then there was a wreck, you know, 5 minutes up the road and you realize that you could have been in it. We don't always get to see all the ways that God protects us because it just, he's just doing it or caring for us because he's just doing it. We don't actually see it. And then sometimes we get to see it and it always magnifies itself to this great degree because we see it. We just realize how close, 10 seconds away from dying. And it shook her up for a couple days. And that's the reality of what God does all the time. He protects and cares. And I feel like that even things like that is a facet of what he's praying here. And to what degree this extends itself. So when we say the threefold promise of Jesus is astounding in its breadth and scope, I don't know if those words do it justice. But such is the love of God for us. Finally, that which man, even dedicated Christian men could never accomplish on their own, Jesus promised to accomplish for them if they would simply be united with one another and with him. So he's going to accomplish it in us if we will be united with one another and united with him. The more we align ourselves with Christ and love and unite with each other in Christ, the more these things that you see prayed for here will be made manifest in our lives. And we'll be the benefactors not only individually, but collectively and as a body in Christ Jesus. All right, we're going to dismiss this in a word of prayer. Gracious Holy Father, we give you thanks once again today for giving us life, for bestowing upon us another day, for showing us great mercy and grace in this. We thank you for this prayer of Jesus, for the reality of what we can grasp hold of, what it means. We praise Jesus for all that he did for us and are thankful that even though we fall short, that his blood covers us. We ask, Father, that you would forgive us our many sins and iniquities. We pray that you would strengthen us to resist, help us to desire to do good and do well. Help us, Father, to live in a way that glorifies you in holiness and not uncleanness. Father, help us to resist the temptations of the flesh. Help us to strive to be those people in the world that reflect Christ in the things we say and do. We ask now, Father, that you'll go with us throughout the remainder of the services, that you'll bless our pastor as he brings a message, you'll guide and direct us in the word, and help us to grow. And Father, we ask these favors and blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.